Greetings, Earthlings. This is a quick inbox review of the new Tamiya kit, the M4A3EH Sherman Easy 8 European Theatre. Now, this is actually not the first kit of this tank that Tamiya have made, even in the last couple of years. In fact, there was a rebox of the Tasker stroke Asuka kit that came out only last year. But this one is an entirely Tamiya-ish offering and contains none of the same sprues as the Tasker Asuka kit, which could be a bit of a shame as that kit is pretty excellent. I must admit I'm not quite sure where the Easy 8 moniker comes from. The crews, as far as I can tell, seem to refer to them as medium tanks with wide tracks, and the official army name for them was Tank Medium M4 with 23-inch tracks. But at some point, they were called the Easy 8, and that seems to be the nickname that stuck, especially amongst modellers. So, let's take a look in the box. Quite a few sprues, all neatly bagged. Yes, these are stapled. I'm sorry if you don't like that, but I can't quite see why you wouldn't. So we have the upper shell for the turret here, and the upper hull. And a sprue with some bits for the turret, including the lower turret and the turret ring, and some transparent bits, the mantlet, the hatches, and two identical sprues containing the wheels and bogies. A flat pack kind of lower hull here, made from sections you'll need to glue together and keep them square. The usual 50 cal sprue that comes with a lot of Tamiya kits. Some more parts for the hull. Some figures. And the tracks made of gluable vinyl. And a very simple decal sheet that just has stars in black and white. And of course, the familiar Tamiya instruction booklet. And some information about the tank in several languages, starting with Japanese, of course. And in English here with a short history of the tank, some call-outs of what the parts are called, and the same in French. And that's your lot. Nothing else in the box. Tamiya instructions are generally some of the clearest you'll find, and these are no exception to that. There's a nice photo here of the finished factory model, and then we're straight on into building the lower hull here. This is the exhaust deflector that can be moved out of the way, and the same as the real thing, putting the suspension and the sprockets on. Assembling the tracks, the wheels all fit on with poly caps, and then assembling the upper hull and the fenders. Nice to see there's actually some blanking here for the sponsons. Adding the periscopes to the drivers and assistant drivers hatches, adding the stays here for the fenders and assembling the turret. The turret fits onto the hull with the familiar sort of bayonet fitment that most Tamiya kits have, and the familiar final stage here, stage 32, which is the sit back and admire it stage. There's a couple of painting guides here, both of them in straight olive drab with nothing but national stars on from the late war period, and that's your lot. So, looking at the sprues, first of all we get two identical sprues for here, the bogies and the wheels. These are the road wheels and the idler wheels. These are the sprockets, you only get this so-called fancy type. These are the track return rollers. And the springs, the horizontal volute springs. These are the stays for the fenders on the sides. Nice separate fuel filler cap there. Brush guards for the lights and the periscopes. And this is to allow figures to be fitted into the hatches. The lower hull comes like this. It's a flat pack arrangement. The lower hull plate here, and the sides, of course, with the mounts for the suspension. This is the rear hull, and a bulkhead to keep everything square. And on the other side, you can see some detail for the underside of the tank. Some nice bolt detail here for the mounts for the suspension. And this is the escape hatch that goes in the floor behind the assistant driver's seat. This is the same old 50 cal sprue that has been with the Tamiya kits since time immemorial, or at least since about 1998, as you can see here. It's pretty basic. Yeah, there's the 50 cal with its spade handles, a pintle mount. These are for a skate rail, which isn't obviously on the Sherman tank, and the whole thing is best thrown away and replaced. The next sprue contains some parts for the turret and some hatches. You can see here the basically the turret ring and lower part of the turret, the luggage rack, searchlight and lifting hooks, the muzzle brake for the gun, loader's hatch and the gun mantlet. Now up close you can see the gun mantlet has a very nice cast texture. There are some proper casting numbers on here. These seem correct as far as I can tell. Now the coaxial port for the 30 cal is a little basic and could do with being drilled out, but the gunner's sight looks fairly reasonable. These are the driver's and assistant driver's hatches, and they've got quite a nice texture on them, although I think it's probably a little bit overdone. You can also see that the handle is moulded in one lump in very 1970s style, and also for some reason the periscope hatches are all moulded shut, which of course they wouldn't be if the periscopes were actually installed. On the underside you can see a couple of nasty ejector pin marks. There's no texture and there are no cast numbers, which should be there. But at least there is a mounting point there for some periscopes, which is something that has been missing in previous Tamiya Sherman kits. Going on here are the this is the gun barrel. Jerry cans. The vent for the back of the turret, some tools, and that wraps it up for that sprue. This sprue contains parts that are generally for the hull. This is the transmission cover, some brush guards, the fenders here with the sponson floors included for once. final drive covers, exhausts, towing pintle, the rear of the hull, engine access doors, rear of the hull plate, exhaust deflector, barrel crotch, spare track links, and the figure. Now he looks exceedingly grumpy, this poor guy, possibly because he's been chopped up here, and you can see, in fact, even his torso has been divided down the middle. But the sculpting does look reasonably good for a plastic figure, especially a Tamiya one. They have improved quite a lot recently. The upper turret shell is a very nice single moulding with some quite realistic but restrained cast texture applied. These are the mounts for the demounted 50 cal machine gun, the pintle mount for that machine gun, antenna base. That's the loader's periscope, the gap for the commander's cupola, and the loader's oval hatch, and some very nice casting numbers. Now these casting numbers appear to be correct for this style of turret. 705-4366 is the drawing number, and that G refers to general steel castings that would have cast the turret. There is a slight mould line down here that will need to be removed without disturbing the cast texture, which might be a bit of a problem, but probably with a bit of care and common sense shouldn't disturb the texture too much. This is the single piece upper hull. I'm very pleased to say that this is an entirely new part and doesn't have anything to do with the rather nasty old M4A3 kit that came out from Tamiya in the late 1980s. Here you can see some very nice weld detail that wasn't indented like it was in the old kit. Some nice casting texture as well. And you can see also here that we have the cast marks for American Steel Foundry's cast armor plant in East Chicago, which is this C logo, and the correct drawing number here for this cast part. Also, it's worth noting some very neat welding texture here. A lot of Sherman welds were really very neatly done. And generally, the whole texture of this cast part is very nicely done indeed. It has a very nice cast pitted effect without looking too badly sandblasted. And this clear sprue is the last hard plastic sprue. We have 6 vision ports here for the commander's vision cupola. There's only one figure, but we have 2 sets of goggles, and we have some lenses for the headlamps. And what's a tank without tracks? Well, it's a pillbox. These are made of a very nice gluable, soft vinyl-y, plasticky type thing. They've got a few little blivets here and there. I should also point out that if you're planning to build the tank from Fury, you'll need to change these. These are T66 tracks. These are the earlier type of tracks. Fury, or the tank that played Fury, actually used a much later T84 rubber chevron dual pin tracks, which makes it really quite a late vehicle. And that's it for our quick roundup of Tamiya's new Sherman kit. Now, this isn't a bad kit at all. In some ways, it's actually got slightly more detail than the Tasker kit, in particular with the casting numbers, which the Tasker kit doesn't have at all. Unfortunately, it's let down a little bit by things like solid grab handles and hatch handles, and the inside of the hatches having those horrible injector pin marks. Also, if the periscopes are fitted, then the periscope hatches really should be open and they're moulded shut on this tank. But these are all fairly minor niggles. This looks to me like a very nice, simple build. It'll certainly look like an M4A3E8. And quite honestly, I think it's going to be a fun kit to put together and will certainly give the Tasker kit a run for its money, especially considering that kit is now very hard to find. So my advice is, if you can get this for a good price, fill your boots and have fun with a Sherman. That's it for now. Hope you enjoyed it. And until next time, happy modelling and goodbye.